My name is Berit Aas. I'm a social scientist and a politician and an activist. And it is the 28th of May in the year 2014. And I'm being interviewed. I have been asked to focus on a few concepts. The one is the concept of cohort. And then a very, very important kind of a statement from Churchill. He was the one who said that the one who doesn't know his history or her history will be very helpless in understanding the future. I am narrowing this concept a little. Because this goes for whole nations, whole populations, and so on. I am very, very interested in youngsters. That means how, in a way, people, special groups, mostly in their youth, are influenced by what's going on in the world around them. And since what's going on is really very, very different in different time periods, I'm focusing a little on special time segments and the people within those time segments who are youngsters or are between 18 to 24 years old. Because there are lots of people who says that it's very much of the attitude formation, also the development of attitudes. And if you think of attitudes as a kind of a structure, some people says that this is really the personality of the person. And so deeply are these attitudes embedded that it's very hard to change them. So with this concept cohort, which I link to another label, the Zeitgeist of a certain period, I would like to go a little deeper in how that affected my own country in Norway. It has affected other countries too, but since it is my own country and my own country's political development and so on, that will be the main kind of examples I will use. But I will start by telling another one. That is, for instance, we were very affected by Germany. Not only during the occupation, but we were very influenced. Our great author, Bjørn Bjørnson, was very, very concerned about Germany. My father, he loved Germany. The philosophers, the musicians. What happened with Germany after the First World War was the peace negotiation in Versailles. And it ended up in a way that was very, very humiliating for the Germans. And some people think that this has affected the German thinking about themselves and the nation to such an extent that they have felt that they were humiliated. And that in some way that has affected the development into the 30s with the Nazism, fascism with Hitler and so on, and the necessity of showing strength and becoming the Third Reich, which really should conquer tremendous amount of land and territory to show how wonderful and how big and how strong Germany was. So this is a kind of thinking that if a group, a certain group, and here then a whole nation, has experienced something very special for them, that will be in their minds for such a long, long time. And it's very, very difficult to get rid of this kind of understanding of themselves if you really, if you don't really work on it. Like in Germany, they, after the World War II, they really hired teachers, peace teachers, in ordinary grammar school and for students to tell them and to cope with what kind of horrible things the Germans did during the war. And a Norwegian peace researcher, Johan Galtung, he told me that these teachers were very good paid, and the better they were able to in some way convey this message and to make youngsters understand and to make them take in and to work on that kind of problem, they got a higher salary. So this is an example which has to do with the whole nation. But let's be a little more specific on the social group to which you belong and what they experienced. So we had in Norway, let's see that we start with the 30s. And you know, when they had the big catastrophe in the banks in New York in 28, 29 and so on, unemployment, poverty, everything happened, and it didn't happen only in USA. It influenced all the economies in the Western world. In Norway, then, we experienced that the workers, both in quite newly developed industrial sites, and also the very small and dependent farmers, under the big farm owners, they started to protest. And we had a kind of labor's uprising. From that time, very many people who are a little older than me carried in their heads a kind of a slogan or a statement which they used all the time when they were angry and went on strikes and so on. And that slogan was, "We will never again stand there with the caps in our hands and bow over necks," you see. Not with the caps in our hands. And that everybody knew the kind of associations, the connotations in which this kind standing with the cap in our hands, what it meant. Because it meant that you stood in front of a director of an industry or a big farmer and you begged to get a job and some money to really feed your family. It was very humiliating. And not only that, but it was something that stuck to the masses of workers in Norway. And it made the foundation for big organization, for the Labour Party, for the Communist Party, for different groups like the Fabians in England. We had serious, very, very important intellectuals that took on this kind of understanding. What do we have to do? We have to organize. We have to go on strike. And it was very many fine leaders, but perhaps the most mostly remembered, that was a man called Einar Gerhardsen, who after the Second World War became a prime minister. And at that time, also communists came into his government. But this started up in the 30s, and what I'm going to really underline is that this phrase was something that kept in the heads of a big group in the population of the laborers. Then, unfortunately, the development it wasn't linear, because we were occupied by the Germans. And that was from 1939, 1940, and we went into the 40s. In Norway, we did not in some way bow our heads. The king flew to England, and he brought with him a government. So every resistance to the occupation, sabotage and whatever, sending out newsletters and so on, that was done by people in the resistance movement. In, you know, Norway is quite big. It has tremendous amount of woods. And from that time, a concept arose, which was the boys in the woods. And everybody, when we talked about the resistance, we really mostly talked about, oh, it's the boys in the woods. They are our home guard, so to say. They take care of the old Norwegian values and practices. So the first half of that 1940, I think I'm in some way trying to put the focus on the middle of the 10-year period. That brought with us this concept. And the war and how we in some way won. It is a funny story all by itself, because during the 30s, we thought that we never would have a new war, so we did not build up our defenses. In fact, we wanted peace. And it was a very, very strong movement that went around with a little with a rifle that was broken. So the 30s was the broken rifles 10-year. But this meant that when the Germans came, we had very little to defend ourselves with. And that could perhaps explain why there were reasonably few deaths. It was fighting from the south of Norway and to the north. And but very many fights did not take place because it wasn't enough weapon. What happened during the first days when they came, and I remember it very well because we flew from my home in Fredrikstad down at the, in the south, up in the middle of the country. And in fact, my father's Chevrolet was riding between the Germans and the king's government, in between. And so we heard the kind of shooting and the mines and whatever it was all the time behind us. But we didn't know at that time that the king was just in front of us. So I remember this very well because I was the old child in that car. My mother was there. My younger brother was there, and my very, very young twin siblings were there. And on the way up to Hamar, a town at Mjøsa, a big inlet in Norway, we heard that shooting, and we had to stop a place. And my father went out, and he took me with him. And we were trained in using a special rifle called the Krag Jørgensen. And I was trained too because I was 12 years old. And he said, you know, Berit, if somebody happens to shoot me, my mother could drive, then you have to take over. So that was very drastic. Of course, I didn't understand the seriousness of that on the way up. But the thing was that we ended up in Hamar, and that was a very cold winter, so the ice was on that islet and inlet, and we drove on the ice over to an island which was called Helgøya, where an aunt of mine had a farm, And we stayed there during the whole operation. The car was taken care of and put into a barn. But anyhow, this is a little story. But the thing is that what happened then, during the war, with the boys in the woods, that was so tremendously strong experiences. So again, as a youngster, between 12 then, I was about 4 or 5 years old, about 17, 18, when the war ended. And then those boys in the woods, they weren't only in the woods, they came from England, they had been trained as pair pilots in Canada, in Little Norway. They came, all of them came home and they marched. They marched up the Karl Johan, which is the main road in Oslo. And then the king came in the boat and the crown prince in an open car waving to all the people on the both the sides of Karl Johan. And of course, it had been quite some women too in the woods. And they were very good at giving out papers. But they weren't allowed to march in that fine kind of column. They had to sit in the night and to pin epaulettes on the shoulders of this kind of pullovers and so, which the boys had. So we saw very many men of power, and we just cried out in our ecstasy. I mean, it was fantastic. And in some way, this kind of deep feeling of freedom and winning, I think that comes up almost every 17th of May, because all over the country we march, you know, in remembrance of the Constitution, which in these days are 200 years, and that we have been occupied so many times, you know, first during Denmark 400 years and then under Sweden. And here these Germans came and thought they could occupy us once more. Also, Norway have to be self-reliant. Norway have to take care of their own kind of laws. So when the common market wanted to get Norway into the common market kind of system, I think that in the depth of the hearts and the souls of Norwegian, it was no. We want to decide for ourselves. We don't know how deep that went, but I'm quite sure that there are some of these deep, deep attitudes which can affect the whole population and which can last for a long, long time. And then sometimes the more actual politics that goes into the understanding of the world of the young people exactly while this kind of freedom came. And it was also an interesting thing about women, because after the war, the leader of the Norwegian Statistical Bureau, he said that we hadn't survived if not the women. The housewives in Norway had not in some way been very, very clever in finding foods in the woods. I mean, picking berries and getting down lots of leaves to feed the rabbits. Because in my house we had out in the shelter 20 rabbits, which I and my younger brother has to attend to. But they became the Sunday dinner. We had hens. And in the garage we had pigs. And My father, who was very keen on history, he gave them names, so that was the names of Danish kings. And he almost cried every Christmas when we had to slaughter King Knut or King Christian. But the interesting thing about the women's situation was that men were so aware of it. So this director of the Statistical Bureau, he calculated in money how much that meant on the state budget. And he put it into the overview of the GNB. And the, it was there for a few years. So we have some people who really have decided that this was worth money. Unfortunately, the Danish and the Swedish and the Finnish, they didn't want to do the same. And that meant that it was thrown out of the state budget after a few years. But around the world, there are people who have done research on this, especially a woman in New Zealand, parliamentarian, conservative parliamentarian, Marilyn Waring. And she has written books, one of them very well known, called If Women Counted. And she took as her point of departure exactly what happened in Norway and how it can be calculated the money value of women's unpaid work. So this is something that also has kept in the heads of Norwegian women once we had some value. But the most important ideas that entered the Norwegian population, and remember now, I talk very much about the young people, those in the 20s and so on. It was the total attitude of the 50s. Now we are rebuilding the country. We are building the country. And that wasn't only that we rebuilt the whole northern part, which the Germans had burnt down, but everything, we should build a society that was just. And in that process, something very interesting happened for sociology, because workers and the directors, for instance, in what you call the ship shop, also the places where they built boats, at Aker, they had a director called CM, and he worked together with the union. The same thing happened to some degree in another very interesting industry. It's now sold to Kraft in America, the chocolate business. And the director there, he was named Trone Holst. And the thing was that the workers in some way were looked upon as very important kind of factors in the production. And the kind of understanding was that we have to buy Norwegian products. We have to make the economy go. And we had economists who became very, very famous, especially one person called Ragnar Frisch, who was almost a kind of a Norwegian Keynes. And the Norwegian economy was talked about, it was given lectures on the radio, and the population was sitting there understanding what is economy, what should be the welfare economy. And behind all this was a very special experience from the 30s, because in the 30s, the revolution in Soviet had an impact on the politicians in Norway. At that time, it was a kind of ideal. It was developing systems for welfare everybody had or should have in the heads of the revolutionary at home, health, education. The kind of understanding from the communist revolution was that without these basic positions, we can't develop art, we can't really do new research, we can't really go to the, all the other rights. So some of our politicians, they went. Einar Gerhardsen, whom I mentioned, he went with his wife, Gerda, to the Soviet Union. So did later health minister, health leader of the health system in Norway, Carl Evang, a man I talked to very much when they come into the 60s. And they should have a committee against smoking. And I went to him and I said, you have to take me into that committee. And I became the only woman in the committee for preventing health harms from tobacco smoking. But that's a story which can come later. But the 50s had this, let us build the society. We are responsible for a society with rights to everybody, to the laborers and to the owners. So you had also quite a clear cleavage between who had the capital and who had the labor. I think this kind of understanding has lasted very, very, for a long, long time. But in the 50s then, I said that this cooperation between the leadership in industry and in production and its workers was a very special thing. It continued out in the 60s and it became a big research project all over the world, this kind of sociology of industry. But it was in the beginning of the 60s. This had some implications when we should build new industry. For instance, the iron industry in Mo i Rana. Mo i Rana is a little town. My husband, he made his thesis in sociology in exactly the development of industry in the new area. And it's one thing that happened, which I haven't thought about until very much later. They were so set, they were so engaged in that, for instance, workers and directors should live together. There shouldn't be one area in the west, the fine buildings, and then one down in the valley, the workers area. And this, they tried to plan this, they tried to do it, but it ended up that way. It ended up with the directors with the best kind of lots. So I didn't think very much of it that time, but I knew that this was something that those three sociologists which made their thesis about that, they wondered how could it happen? That in some way things developed in such a way that it became something else than they had planned for. Very interesting, this kind of, that the plan, organization, are starting out with a goal, and suddenly when the whole thing goes on, it doesn't happen at all. Sometimes it's really turned around. But the 60s came, and in some way the 60s were very colored by this idea that we have built the Norwegian society, we can build societies all over the world, we can go into this kind of foreign areas and the poor country and the underdeveloped countries and we'll help them so they can be social democrats just like us. very, very funny, but it really shows the big ego of the Norwegians. But it wasn't only Norwegians. It was the Swedish with its sida. And as we were concentrated very much about African countries, they were concentrated about countries in South America. And Danida. Also, we should really help the world. And because we had the right thinking, and we had the right ideology, and we had the right kind of understanding of economy. In fact, as a later Prime Minister Gro Harlem Brundtland said, the characteristic of a Norwegian is that we are good. this big ego. But we started to do that. And the thing was that it was a very happy time, because we knew quite much about the world. Norway was at that time the country that had the highest number of missionaries per capita. I think we perhaps still have it yet, and not only that, but we had a big merchant marine, also ships that went all over the world. And these sailors come home and they could tell us what happened in small countries and big countries. So the Norwegians were, we were very concerned, and we were very happy about our relationship to the world. And that was also in some way also important in the UN, because we had this kind of self-reliance. So the first two general secretaries, they came from Norway and from Sweden. From Norway came a man called Trygve Lie. And from Sweden came Himmelstrand. Nei, Hammarskjöld. Hammarskjöld was his name. And with the Human Rights Charter, which Evelyn Roosevelt really was the force behind in San Francisco, and which then was acquired, or which was taken into the human rights of the UN. This idea about building just societies was something that we thought was very fine. And all around Norway, all these small groups established themselves. And that was missionary groups, and very often women's and children's group. You know, a missionary group for the sailors, for the Zulus, for the Africans, for the... it was a tremendous amount of places that had their own kind of missionary groups. And they sewed, and they knitted, and they sold these things in big kind of lotteries, and the money went to build these kind of societies among the heathens. Yeah. And I had one uncle who became a missionary in Madagascar, and I had an aunt who married an Icelandic missionary. She was a nurse in China and was thrown out by Mao. And I remember when they were home in the late 30s and after the war, we were sitting there listening, you know, how is it really to save all these heathens everywhere? I mean, yellows or dark brown or blacks, they should be saved for Christ. And my father's family was a family that thought that missionaries was what everybody should be. So they gave all their children a good education so that they could go out and save the heathens. My father protested. He developed himself as a free thinker, as they call them. And he was very concerned about science. And he thought that Darwin had a good point of view. So he wasn't really too popular in his own family. And he didn't get this kind of support that the others got. So he had to take a job in a shop and earn his money. And he had to go to a special school to take his a college exam that allowed him to go into the teacher's college. And he had a big dream to once be an engineer and to be one that really invents things. So I have a little article about everything he invented. And that wasn't small things either. He magnetized iron under freeze. But he was a funny man, because the moment he had done something, he was satisfied. He didn't want to sell it, so he never earned a cent. But in the 60s, it had this kind of small groups. And it had it went together with some of the same ideas that I located in my father. It was developed a kind of a society in Norway, humanetikere, that means humanistic ethics and association for that. And that grew very fast. I have a feeling that perhaps the religious life in Norway were too fundamentalistic for many. But that the ethos, that understanding what's right and what is wrong, that they found an other base for that. And all this small kind of interest group, groups of meaning, it was very funny, but around in the 60s, they were led very often of women. That could perhaps also mean something when we came to the 70s and the women's liberation in Norway. But the 60s were very, very, very concerned about globalization in that meaning. And it was almost a little kind of shock when we had a book written by a Danish female economist called Esther Boserup, The Role of Women in Development. I don't remember exactly the title of that book. But the thing was that she went to the nations south of Sahara in Africa and found that very much of the money we sent went to the elite, to the 10-15% of the richest of those in power. So the distribution of wealth in the countries which we favored was not what we thought it should be. It took many years until this prime minister, again a woman, Gro Harlem Brundtland, said that 20% of the money that we forward should be used to health and schooling. But we are in the 60s. We are in the end of the 60s. We have had a very special kind of research. A Canadian woman who came to Norway and were interested in women's representation in the parliament. I don't remember, I wonder if it was as much as 16 women in the parliament. We got the suffrage, also the right to vote, in 1913, and we were, I think we were the second or the third in the world who gave this common suffrage to women. The situation was, I think, that the labor had to accept it, because they think that to get the common kind of rights to vote for men, we have to let those bourgeoisie women get it too. Because it was, of course, well educated women, just like in England, who took on this work to insist that women should have a general voting right. But the 60s, in the end, something started to really move. And there was a book about women in the parliament. And they were very few. So two very well-known women in Norway, an editor, the first women editor of a daily, a center person, a women's farmers person, Birgit Borgersen-Vik. It just came out, her biography. It's a very nice biography. Because she went after the prime minister and she said, what about the women? What about the women? And was able to introduce a kind of a rule or a law that said that if a government should appoint a person to a government committee, they should ask those organizations to send a name both of a woman and a man. That was quite interesting. And I was quite surprised that this was not mentioned at the Mexico City Women's Conference. But and then the other one was a woman called Toril Skar, who had always become a parliamentarian under a very radical new party called the Social People's Party. That was a very interesting party because it said we want to be in the middle. We are the third idea. We want to be neutral between USA and Soviet. Those two women, they started making a committee, and they were those who started to push. Now we want to have more women in parliament. So we entered this 70s with the same kind of understanding that other people in the West, especially in the USA and Canada, had, that we want an equal representation in the parliament, or not equal, but a greater representation. And they worked very hard on that within all the parties. And at a certain point at the end of the 60s, they were able to approach both the prime minister of the bourgeoisie and also the prime minister of the labor. And in some way, the one said about the other, okay, if the other does it, we will put women up on the ballot, high on the ballot, so that there becomes a chance that they can increase the members of women parliamentarians. So that started in Norway, and therefore we were very ripe. When Jo Frimann came to Norway and gave a lecture about liberation of women. And remember, we knew the word liberation because it was liberation fighters in Vietnam. I shouldn't forget to talk about that, which tremendous impact it had. This kind of understanding that it wasn't only going to go our way in the developing countries. We had to call them developing countries because to call them underdeveloped, that was in some way to shame them. So we had to really adjust our language. But the interesting thing was that we knew now that the distribution system in these countries wasn't something that we couldn't rely on. But it started to become wars. Biafra. Very, very funny. For us Norwegian, we sent food and we sent helpers to distribute food. And we were very naive, because I think that the meaning was really to make that nation hungry, or perhaps to starve them out. It was just a few years later in 68-69 in Ljubljana that this Kissinger's theory about the dispensable nations became a central kind of concept. But then Vietnam War. I think we couldn't understand it, but we were very much under the American influence, so we were told that this was necessary, because otherwise it would be communist all over. It would be, and the Americans had to help out the South Vietnams, and I think most of the Norwegian people believed that the Americans had some rights to be there in the beginning, until we heard about Agent Orange, we heard about the bombings, we heard about the brutal kind of war against the civilians. And I remember that at the end of that war, it was said that every family who had as much as four children had lost one child, and the numbers of civilians that was killed. For the first time, it wasn't 50-50 like it was in the Second World War. We thought then it was 50% civilians and 50% soldiers. The First World War, we thought it was 5% civilians and 95% soldiers. But now the whole picture changed, so they thought that it was more than 90% that those killed were the civilians. And only a few, I think it was 59,000 American soldiers that are listed on this big black gravestone in Washington. So, you see, the horror of the Vietnam War very much came to us, I think, through Sweden, because they were a neutral country at the time. We had joined NATO, also the Atlantic Pacts with England and with America, also NATO. And that was a military pact. And we were very, very much under the influence of America. But Sweden was neutral. And they had a prime minister, Olof Palme. And I think he played a tremendous role in understanding what was going on in Vietnam. He was up front in the kind of demonstrations against the war and so on. A very, very courageous, very fine man. Also a very, very good feminist. And he meant very much. And he was killed, of course. He was killed in the end. Just like Hammarskjöld. Those good men, they are few. And in some way, they are not too popular in those patriarchal power and weapon associations. But anyhow, I told you about the 60s. We are entering the 70s. Jo Freeman is coming to Norway. She tells about Students for Democratic Action in America, a fine, big student group, which really were very, very important in the women's movement too. But in the beginning, the women in this association, they were allowed only to typewrite, and to copy and to make coffee and to make love to those men who were mighty. So they started an uproar in the Student for Democratic Action. And then also in the 70s, I think it was in 64, that Betty Friedan, a journalist in America, wrote a book about the problem that has no name. That was the first big feminist book that was pointing out to which extent women had no power everywhere in patriarchal society. And then in Norway, very many of us, and I had become a politician, I was in the community council. And I was also a member of the Labour Party. So I was the fourth alternate to a parliamentarian job also. You know, you have one that is elected and then you have different kinds of alternates. So I did quite much in the community council because I had been studying accidents, and especially then, of course, traffic accidents and also accidents that hit children and pedestrians. And this community in which I live was the third worst community when really we were hitting and killing people in traffic. And you know, it was 440 communities, so we were really at the bottom. And that reason was that we were very rich people. And people had bought American big cars, but there was no sidewalks, no tunnels, no bridges. So I used this as a research project and was then also prognosing in which places we would have heavy accidents, including children on the way to school. But anyhow, that was some of my research activity at that time. But I entered also the community council, and I saw that whenever I brought some of these issues up, very often you could see men whisper to each other when I said, women are so concerned, they are so scared about sending their children out on the ordinary road where you have no sidewalks and it's snow, and we have these big lorries coming with very heavy loads. And then you could hear them say, oh, you know, it must be that day for those ladies. You know, the day before menstruation, isn't it? And we were only 12 out of 47 women, but all the women understood that because they had children to send out on these roads. And then, interesting enough, we just decided we need to capture the council. We need a majority of women. And in Norway we had election laws for communities which allowed us to take ballots and to move people from the one place to the other. And not only that, but we had the right to cumulate. We had to give those people which we moved around on different ballots. You know, you have different parties and each party had a ballot of 47 people, really. They wanted to take all, of course. And they had some on the top, which was then cumulated, as I said. And the law, the election law at that time, gave us the opportunity that when we found one of the ballots which had no women, we could move women from all the other ballots over and we could give them an extra vote. So in some way, none of those men on that list had a chance. And of course then when the election ballots were counted, we were a majority of women in the community council of Asker. Of the 47, I think we were 45, no, 25 women, and we had the majority. That was something that went on two other places too, also in the Oslo city and in Trondheim city, the women took the majority. Because we sent people around to the different kind of election districts and taught them how they could change the ballots so that they got more women into it. Men was so angry. And in my party, we had a social scientist who said, "Oh, this was a pen revolution, also a writing revolution. It wasn't really, it didn't come from the women." And then some of us started to count and analyze, and we found out that equality in the community council was something that would happen in 120 years or something, when it was used the speed up to then. So we said that we can't wait so long. But so the political kind of life then of course differed into a series of women's groups, and they made women's groups after Jo Frimann, different Brødre Roser, the Women's Front, and we had then earlier a series of women's rights association which were 100 years old almost from the suffragettes and so on. And they united beautifully, and it was very clear what they said, because remember now you have had all these women's small groups, missionary groups, human rights groups, so, and a big association of housewives, 70,000. And here in my community, it was the leader of the Housewives Association who really was the big strength behind the teaching of women on how what they should do. So this was something that really was a news all over the world. And of course they thought that women would not destroy the whole community because we obviously were so dumb. We had no this kind of solid political background, you know. And some men were so angry because they had been sitting, they had had seats in this community council for years, and they were thrown out. That was 71. We had this election for the country to become a member of the common market in 72. And I was organizing a big group of women who I wanted to say no. They came from almost all the parties. And that was so clear that the men in Norway, they said, "Oh no, you know, we don't want to have European ships in taking all the fish." And the church people said, "Oh, we don't want to be Catholic." And then the farmer said, "Look what has happened in Germany. They have taken small farmers away, and lots of hundred thousands of farmers have no farms anymore." And then from a women's point of view, we had this working for equality and found out that in France women couldn't erase their own account in the banks without their husband's kind of accept. And in some of the German, in Bayern, I think it was, women couldn't be allowed to work for money if their husbands didn't allow it. In Ireland, you had a horrible thing. They couldn't work if they were married. So there was some of us traveled around in Europe to see what women's conditions were, and we said to the men, who was the main kind of force to organize against the common market, we want to vote too. But in some way, we want to concentrate on other issues than you, because you say then we will be forced to have a common kind of currency. The banks will be ordered from. They had all this kind of industrial, political, economic ideas, while the women. And we were lots of women's groups that came into Women Against the EEC, as you say. We looked for other things. And I went to those men and I said, you have to widen out the kind of total goals or reasons for not joining, because the women have other kinds of ideas. And they looked at me and they said, are you going to make feminism out of this too? And they were very angry. They didn't understand that women had, to a certain extent, other kind of interest invested in welfare and in all the rights that they had acquired during the last 60, 70 years. But the men wouldn't let us join, if not on their premises. So we had a women economist, Harriet Holter, a friend of mine. She was an economist, so she could join. But the women, fortunately, the farmers understood us. So the Farmers Association gave us 10,000 crowns to hire a special office, and we made a special organization. And those who led that organization was one woman from the Farmers' Party, it was me from the Labour, and it was the women from the Christian People's Party. And we traveled all over the country. And some place, for instance, in Stavanger, 3,000 women came from all around in boats and buses to listen to us. So the no, though people who didn't want to join, they won in 72. Then my party goes so mad at me that they threw me out. There were almost half of the members of the Labour Party who wouldn't go into the common market, because also of these rules, you know, free movement of capital, free movement of workers, and all this Roma tracti thing, which was very capitalistic and not welfare oriented at all. So the Labour Party was so afraid that I would be elected to Parliament that they suspended me under the nomination period. Which said, you know, when we have done all the nomination and so on, then you can come back again. I've never heard any party doing anything like that, Liz. But that they did it to me and a few others, suspended us so that we could not be put up on the ballot for those in this county that wanted me to enter Parliament. And then when the nomination was over, they invited me into the party again. And it's written a book about it. It's so funny. And it calls really, when the whip was used in the community of Asker in the Labour Party. It's a tremendous book. But the thing was that when I was invited in again, of course, I had lots of thoughts about how popular I was in Labour Party. So in fact, I left after a few weeks. And then I was asked by a big union leader to make a new party, a new Labour Party. And that is a story all by myself. And I did that. And that became the Democratic Socialists. And it's really a story. But in the 70s then, I think the important thing that was when we made that party, the Democratic Socialists, I said, I will not be elected as a leader unless I am promised three things. I will never vote against women's interests. I will that there is the in the bylaws, it shall be said clearly then for every committee that we make, it must be 40% women, also on the board. And the third thing is, and that was the most difficult for them to swallow, it was 54 men who sat in that kind of big auditorium. And I said, and you are not allowed to call me four man. My label will be chairwoman. And I thought they would die. I was standing there in front of them and said this. And they swallowed it. And then I said, and then I think it's quite nonsense to only make one more little party. Because now we have a small communist party, we have a small party, or the Socialist People's Party. Let's join together in an alliance, an electoral alliance. And let's get enough seats so that we get some power. And I worked so hard in 2 years, every day. Male politicians of my party, they are forgotten. But that was in the bylaws. And from that time, in my party, in the community council and so on, it was the socialist left, also the socialist election alliance, that was the party that elected most women to the community councils. And that was the starting of the quota instrument, which finally ended up in the early 80s in a proposal to change the constitution so that it would be a fair representation of men and women in parliament. But we haven't come to the 80s yet. We are still in the 70s. But the 70s was all over the Western world, very flavored, very characterized by the fact that the UN started to understand that women's rights were very important and that it was a humanitarian principle. So I was sent to the UN as a UN delegate in 73. I should mention then that we went into the election activity and we won 16 seats. And the Labour needed us to get the majority. But we were not able to use that kind of marginal thing to get our things through. That hadn't happened before, I think. So we became very much a kind of a supporter of the labor. But anyhow, the interesting thing was that we got those 16 seats. And I was sent then to as a member of this social alliance to New York and to the second committee, the Committee on Social and Human Rights. I tried to get into the first because the first is the one on military weapon. But the thing is that as Alva Myrdal said, you know, the Swedish Nobel Prize receiver, she said, you can be an 18 years old for a small country and you will have a place in the first committee, but women are not welcomed. I had really to be, have been a minister in the Swedish government and to be a member of the disarmament committee in Geneva to be allowed to enter the first committee. It was the men's committee. But in this second committee, I was sitting there between two beautiful men. The one was from Nigeria, the other was from Oman. And the man from Nigeria, he must have been a kind of a chief or something. He had a big, beautiful robe of light blue silk and a kind of a hat with beautiful gold embroideries. And very stout and so on. And the other one on my right side, he was from Oman, and he was very nice, very glittering eyes and brown and beautiful white kind of, I don't know what to call it. But the thing was that they were so beautiful that I didn't dare to speak to them. So they spoke to me, and this man from Oman, he said, Mrs. Oz. Oh, at that time you shouldn't say Mrs., you should say Ms. Ms. Where is your country? Yeah. And I was trying to tell him, and he said, oh, I see. It's where the ice bears goes in the street. Yeah. And so I said again, and where is your country? I didn't know where Oman was. And he told about that, and Oman has very, very interesting background. Especially when it comes to the relationship to men and women and to homosexuality. But I had to read that in anthropology until I really found out what Oman was. And then with my neighbor on the left side, of course, I had all these stories from Africa. So we had interesting small conversations. But the most interesting thing was that then was the planning of the UN Women's Conference in Mexico City. And I had thought that these men from underdeveloped countries wouldn't accept it, but they said, oh, it's really in time. It's really very important that women get their rights too. So they supported very strongly this planning of the women's conference in Mexico City, and the thing was that it was a quarrel about what they should label it, because the Western men wouldn't like to have the word peace involved, while lots of men from the developing countries said, oh, we support our women who want to have it labeled equality, development, and peace. Because they know that if it is not peace in the country, they will not have the force to really develop other things. Schooling and small industries and farmland and so on. War is destroyed, completely destructing everything. Destroying everything. So that was the 70s in Mexico City. We had lots of people there. And it was important that the economists, they ended up by reminding us that it was three figures which came out of this conference. And that was that in developing countries, women did 75% of all the life-supporting work. A little for money, but most, 80% of the food in Africa came from women's agriculture. So 75%, they said, that is what women really support these countries with. And the 25% of men, you find them sitting under the palms discussing religion and politics, or they are in wars. And then the second figure